Hi everybody, this is Dr. A, and in this last video on basics of urinalysis, we're going to look at other tests of renal function. So obviously urinalysis is the initial and most cost-effective screen for the evaluation of renal function. It's also the least invasive. However, additional testing are often needed for most abnormalities, and then we're going to turn to blood tests, which is what we're fixing to look at. As the kidneys fail, whether acutely or chronically, the end products of nitrogen accumulate, so it causes increases in what we call non-protein nitrogen, which, if you will, protein varies from carbs and fats as it contains nitrogen, whereas carbs and fats do not contain nitrogen. And when protein is used up and broken down, you get these non-protein nitrogenous compounds, and we can measure those. They're usually waste products. So when the kidneys fail, then it is reflected in a rise in blood urea nitrogen and a rise in serum creatinine. Let's start with blood urea nitrogen. So blood urea nitrogen is actually the concentration of nitrogen as urea in the serum and not in whole blood as the name implies. So it really probably should have been named serum urea nitrogen or plasma urea nitrogen, but we named it blood urea nitrogen, and that's what stuck. BUN is usually measured by an indirect method that generates ammonium from urea using the enzyme urease, and then that ammonium produced can be detected by a second chemical reaction in quantitatives. You can get an exact concentration. Even though urea can be measured, it cannot be used by itself to assess kidney function. However, it can be used in conjunction with other labs, laboratory, and clinical data to assess or monitor hydration, renal function, protein tolerance, catabolism, and to predict the risk of uremic syndrome in patients with severe renal failure, and that concentrations above 100 milligrams per deciliter are associated with the risk of uremic syndrome. So you can use it to monitor hydration because as a person becomes dehydrated, their blood urea and oxygen levels are simply going to be more concentrated in the blood and therefore rise. But as soon as you rehydrate the patient, the blood urea and oxygen levels usually come back into the normal ranges. So in part, it can be used to assess kidney function because they will increase when the kidney function declines. And because the nitrogen comes from the protein, it also fluctuates with protein intake and protein catabolism, etc. And so assessing protein tolerance can be something that needs to be done, especially if a patient's in liver failure. Anyway, so the BUN can be quite useful for that. A BUN is expected to be elevated in chronic glomerulonephritis, pyelonephritis, and other causes of chronic renal diseases, acute renal failure, decreases in renal perfusion as seen in shock, so this is decrease in blood flow to the kidneys, a urinary tract obstruction, severe congestive heart failure, and dehydration. They're expected to be decreased in normal pregnancy, and this is probably just delusional because when a person is pregnant, there is an increase in fluid volume, decreased protein intake, IV fluid administration, and some instances of liver diseases because the liver can't process the proteins very well. The limitations of the BUN test. So the BUN may not be significantly increased until the glomerular filtration rate has been decreased by at least 50%. So kidney function has been lost at about 50%. It is a highly variable substance and is influenced by a number of factors, especially diet and hydration status, as I've explained again. So diet, the more protein one takes in, the higher the BUN could be. And hydration status, a dehydrated person would have a higher BUN level than a hydrated person. The reference range is going to be 8 to 23 milligrams per DL. And again, you can see some slight variations in those ranges between labs, methods, geographical areas. Next, we have the serum creatinine. So the serum creatinine is produced in the muscle, and it's a degradation product of creatine and creatine phosphate. Creatine phosphate is used for energy storage in muscle. It is the storage form of ATP that your muscles store up for when activity is increased and extra ATP is needed. creatinine concentration in the serum will vary little from day to day in patients with healthy kidneys, and they're definitely related to muscle mass. Even though there's an inverse relationship between serum creatinine and kidney function, the serum creatinine should not be the only test used to evaluate kidney function. The BUN can provide information also, so the BUN and creatinine together are very useful to assess kidney function, and of course the clinical picture has to be in consideration also. Factors that affect serum creatinine values are going to be the muscle mass. So higher muscle mass will be higher creatinine, lower muscle mass will be lower creatinine values. Age, sex, race, drugs. So certain drugs can affect your creatinine level because it can also affect how the kidneys function. Methods of the laboratory analysis and low protein diets. The lab methods that are currently used to measure serum creatinine levels are the Aklin-Pikrit method, the Jaffe method. That is the most commonly used method for creatinine assessment. There's also an inorganic enzymatic method and high-pressure liquid chromatography. Serum creatinine is expected to be elevated in renal diseases and renal insufficiency with a decreased glomerular filtration. So you'll see uremia or azotemia if it is severe. Uremia is an accumulation of blood urea nitrogen. Azotemia is an accumulation of all waste products, including BUN, creatinine, but also ammonia, uric acid, etc. And be elevated in urinary tract obstruction. Elevated and reduced renal blood flow, including congestive heart failure, shock, and dehydration. Decreases that increase the creatinine concentration include also skeletal muscle necrosis and atrophy. Sorry, those were diseases that increase creatinine concentration. So that's skeletal muscle necrosis or atrophy, trauma, rapidly progressing muscular dystrophy, and myasthenia gravis. Serum creatinine are decreased in debilitation, meaning somebody is like bedbound. Obviously, they're going to be losing muscle mass, so they're also decreased in decreased muscle mass and in inadequate dietary protein, because then the body's going to go scavenge it from the muscles and break down those muscles. The limitation of the serum creatinine, so with reduced renal blood flow, the serum creatinine rises less quickly than the BUN, and it decreases more slowly with dialysis, so it doesn't fluctuate as easily as that BUN does. So creatinine does have advantages over BUN, though, because it is not as dependent on diet, hydration, and protein metabolism as the BUN. So those things do not move it the way it moves BUN. Unusually large amounts of non-creatinine chromogens, so those are things that are not creatinine that contribute color to the chemical reaction, such as uric acid, glucose, fructose, acetone, acetate, pyruvic, and ascorbic acids, and the serum can all cause a falsely increased creatinine result. A high bilirubin can cause a falsely low serum creatinine result with both the alkaline and the enzymatic assays, and the creatinine may only become significantly abnormal when about half the nephrons have stopped functioning in chronic progressive renal diseases. Again, so these tests are good, but they don't detect abnormalities in renal function till about half the nephrons are gone, which we really want to pick it up on sooner than that. The reference range for serum creatinine is 0.5 to 1.3 milligrams per DL. Next is the creatinine clearance test. The most common clinical uses for that creatinine clearance and the serum creatinine include assessing kidney function in patients with acute or chronic kidney disease, monitoring the effects of drug therapies on slowing the progression of kidney disease, monitoring patients on nephrotoxic drugs, and determining dosage adjustments for renally eliminated drugs, so drugs that are cleared by the kidneys and not the liver. So how do we measure this creatinine clearance? The creatinine clearance requires a collection of a 24-hour urine specimen. So for that, you have to give very clear and thorough instructions to the patient so that you get an appropriately collected specimen. Things like you have to empty the bladder before you start the timing of the collection. Things like you have to absolutely collect every bit of urine that's produced. And the accuracy and precision of that collection is important, and you have to have complete, careful time collection that is very essential. Refrigeration throughout the collection is required, and failure to do so could give some falsely low results. A blood specimen is collected either at the beginning or the end of the 24-hour urine collection period for the determination of the serum creatinine in that 24-hour window. The concentration of creatinine in the urine and in the serum is determined using the Jaffe reaction, which uses alkaline picric acid solution to produce a bright orange-red complex. The creatinine clearance is expressed in milliliters per minute and is determined using the urine creatinine concentration, the serum creatinine concentration, the volume of the specimen, and the time period of collection. Additionally, a correction is necessary to account for the differences in body surface area and thus muscle mass, meaning for the same height, people can have different weights and different builds and stuff. And so we use a standard body surface area and then the patient's body surface area to correct for and account for these differences between people. So the body surface area of the patient is determined from formulas that either relate height and weight to the body surface area, or more simple, there's normograms that can provide the same relationship, which are like little charts that you can look at. With computers now, usually they just pull the dip from the demographics. It pulls the height and current weight, and it calculates the body surface area for you. So the formula that is used to calculate the creatinine clearance is, take the urine creatinine result in milligrams per dl from that 24-hour urine specimen, the serum creatinine results in milligrams per dl, and so it's the urine creatinine divided by the serum creatinine, and we're going to do that times the volume in mils divided by the number of minutes in 24 hours. So the volume, this has to be measured, so get the containers, you have to measure the exact volume and enter that in there that was produced in 24 hours. And then times, this is the normalized body surface area divided by the body surface area of the patient. And so that should give you the creatinine clearance in milliliters per minute. So the abbreviation UCR is urine creatinine concentration in milligrams per deciliter. SCR, serum creatinine, is concentration of serum creatinine in milligrams per deciliter. The V is for volume. So first determine the volume per minute based on the 24-hour volume. There are 1,444 minutes in 24 hours. 1.73 is the standard body surface area, and the BSA is the patient's body surface area determined on based on the patient's height and weight. So there you go. In spite of the many variable influencing creatinine clearance, this estimate of glomerular filtration rate, GFR, has good clinical utility. So the reference range for females is 60 to 115 milliliters per minute, and for males is 70 to 135 milliliters per minute. And the eGFR, the estimated GFR, can also be found on any report that contains a serum creatinine level, and that is estimated using demographic data from the patient's chart and the serum creatinine level, but it's not the same as the actual creatinine clearance test. And there you go.